Hey bio students, this lesson is going to be on how neurons are organized into nerves, or the title that I have here, Neurons versus Nerves. We have, of course, already talked at length about neurons. We've talked about the structure of neurons, the different parts, the function of the different parts, generation of the action potential, how the message is passed on from one neuron to another. We haven't really talked about nerves. So just as a reminder, neurons, they are single individual cells. They are microscopic. They can be very, very long, but they are still microscopic in nature. They are conducting cells. They send information. They might be surrounded by multiple supporting cells, the glial cells. In the case of the peripheral nervous system, those are the Schwann cells that make up the myelin sheath. But neurons themselves, they are in fact a single cell. We have, of course, talked about sensory neurons. They are the ones that pick up information from your sense organs, your sensory receptors, and they take that information for processing toward the central nervous system. Now, most of the sensory neuron is located in the peripheral nervous system. So I'll put in PNS here because that's where most of it is found, but the information is going toward the central nervous system. For motor neurons, the opposite in terms of the direction. So motor information goes from the central nervous system toward the peripheral nervous system, responsible for the control of muscles, the control of glands. Once again, these are located primarily in the peripheral nervous system. When we talk about the interneurons, these are restricted to only the central nervous system, which of course is the brain and the spinal cord. All of those are conducting cells. All of them do send messages. So what about nerves? What is the difference? What is the distinction between a neuron and a nerve? For the most part, when we talk about nerves, they are in the peripheral nervous system. They contain tracts that are made up of, well, here I have thousands, but it may be more than thousands. It may be tens of thousands. It may be millions of individual neurons. Now, some of these nerves are strictly sensory. For example, the optic nerve, which takes information from your eyes toward the brain, your auditory nerve, which takes information from your ears toward your brain, they are strictly sensory. There are some other ones that are strictly motor. They only are made up of motor neurons. And there are some other ones which are a combination of both sensory and the motor neurons. So because neurons are single cells and they fit into the category of sensory or motor, or the interneurons, they do carry information, and that information is in one direction. So we've talked primarily about the motor neurons, and what we know is that the information goes from the dendrite end through the cell body, through the axon, to the axon terminal. So it is only traveling in that one direction. In the case of the motor, it's going to be away from the central nervous system. In the case of the sensory, it's going to be toward the central nervous system. Interneurons, of course, carrying information within the central nervous system. When we talk about the nerves, though, because they are made up of many, many, many thousands, tens of thousands, millions of neurons, they actually can carry information in both directions if they are mixed nerves. So once again, some nerves are strictly motor, some of them are strictly sensory, but many of them are mixed. So they are made up of both sensory and motor neurons, and it is for that reason that they can carry information in both directions. So these nerves, when the information is going to and from the central nervous system, they enter typically through the spinal cord. And let's just jump ahead to this picture here. Take a look at this cross section through the spinal cord and point out a couple of things here. So first of all, structures that we can see, visible macroscopic things that we can see in the spinal cord. In the center here, this kind of butterfly shape that we see here, this is made up of interneurons. This is made up of the cell bodies of interneurons. This is made up of neurons that don't have any myelin. Because there is no myelin, myelin is white in color, and because we don't have the myelin, this is actually gray in color, and it's referred to as the gray matter. We saw already in the brain that there is gray matter. The gray matter is on the outside of the brain in what's called the cerebral cortex. So with the brain, gray matter is on the outside. With the spinal cord, it's reverse. The gray matter is on the inside. So what do you find around the outside of the spinal cord here? Well, this is the white matter. And again, it's a reversal compared to what we see in the brain. In the brain, it's the interior where we do have the myelinated neurons. With the spinal cord, it is the outside. Now, keep in mind, if there is no myelin sheath, that means that it does not have the ability to repair and regenerate. So if there is damage to the gray matter of the brain, the gray matter of the spinal cord, it is for the most part not repairable. It is permanent damage if the gray matter is damaged in the brain or the spinal cord. So what else can we see here? Well, we can see on both the lower left side and the upper right side that we do have some nerves identified. So what we can also do is kind of figure out what is the front of the spinal cord and what is the back of the spinal cord. If you recall, the frontal lobe of the brain is responsible for voluntary motor control. The front of the spinal cord is where the motor nerves are going to be exiting the spinal cord. So if we take a look at this picture here, what we are identifying is a sensory route for this one here. This means this information must be going toward the central nervous system. What we see on the other side is the motor route. This one must be going away from the central nervous system. In the brain, it is the frontal lobe that's responsible for voluntary motor control. So try and think of it this way: front of the brain motor, front of the spinal cord is where this motor route is going to go out of. So that means that this is the front of the spinal cord. This is the back of the spinal cord. Parietal lobe is in behind the frontal lobe in the brain. Sensory information goes in the back portion. Sensory information comes in the back portion of the spinal cord. What do we see just outside of the spinal cord? Well, we actually see these two that come together. It's identifying it here as a spinal nerve, and this one would be referred to as a mixed nerve because it is made up of both sensory neurons and of motor neurons as well. So if we are talking about reflexes, which of course we have talked about, then it does typically just involve the spinal cord. It doesn't involve the brain. So in terms of a reflex, what we would have is we would have some sort of a sensory receptor. I'll just put R for receptor. That's going to detect the information, some sort of stimuli that could possibly harm the body. That information is going to travel in through this mixed nerve, be separated, come in through the sensory route that we see here, and then in the spinal cord, that's where we're going to have a connection. So right in here, what I'm drawing in green, that is now going to be our interneuron. This interneuron is going to do this rudimentary processing, make a connection right away with the motor neuron or motor neurons, and that information is then going to go right back out through this motor route, through the mixed nerve, and eventually down to our effector, which is probably going to be a muscle, to elicit a certain response. The final thing that I'll mention here, very important fluid that we have, cerebral spinal fluid, or CSF. It is located in both and around the brain and the spinal cord. In relation to the brain, it surrounds the brain. It also fills the cavities or ventricles that we do find in the brain. For the spinal cord, it's around the outside, and it also runs right through the center of the spinal cord. What does this cerebral spinal fluid do? Three things to keep in mind: a transport medium for nutrients and hormones. And when I say nutrients, we're not talking about gases like oxygen and carbon dioxide. That's transported through the blood. This is probably the biggest one here, acting as a shock absorber. So very, very delicate tissues when we're talking about the brain and the spinal cord. They do have to be protected. They are surrounded by bony tissue, the skull in the case of the brain, the vertebrae in the case of the spinal cord. But bone is very, very hard. So there needs to be a cushion between the soft tissue, the spinal cord and the brain, and between the bone. And this cushion is the cerebral spinal fluid. So acting as a shock absorber and also for the removal of some wastes. And once again, the waste that we're not talking about here is carbon dioxide.